Small bowl, my chips.
Good evening, and welcome to the Cape Elizabeth School Board Regular Business Meeting on Tuesday, January 10th, 2017. I almost said 16. Please join me for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Item number one, adjustment to the agenda. My understanding is this might come in communications.
Sure.
So we will have the Ponco STEM field trip proposal during communications.
Okay.
Item number two, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the school board minutes as listed under two, A, B, C, and D.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item number three, comments by student representatives. We're going to start with our high school representatives because there's a calculus exam tomorrow.
That is true.
So Kinnan and Meg.
The vibe at the school has been definitely a lot more stressful in the past few weeks as we're getting closer to midterms. There definitely have been teachers trying to make sure that we know all the material going into the midterm season. So you can definitely sense the stress in the hallways, but overall I think, especially underclassmen, are handling it pretty well.
As far as what's been going on since the new year, we've been meeting with a group of students to discuss school climate, and that group has, I know that Mr. Coulter came into one of the meetings, and we've been talking about school climate and like sort of school bonding and getting the arts and the sports together, and it's I think it will do a really great job in improving the school climate. As far as athletics, all sports teams are in full swing. The hockey team recently had a fundraiser where they picked up Christmas trees around town. All sports are doing really well. We had a lockdown drill today, which went really well. Yeah, and I think that's about it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
At this time, would middle school representatives Maggie Cochran and Claire McDonald step up? Thank you, ladies, both for coming tonight.
Thank you. As you know, my name is Claire McDonald, and I am a seventh grade representative. And our school has been very busy with activities like Stuff the Bus, which is our non-perishable items food fundraiser. And the donations go to Preble Street Food Pantry to help feed families in need. We also have done a 7th and 8th grade futsal tournament pretty recently, which raised money for Camp Sunshine, which is a local summer camp for children with terminal illnesses. And last, 7th and 8th graders have the option to be a peer helper, which is a mentor to younger children. And peer helpers play games with their child weekly and become a familiar face in the school or a friend. Our school, to conclude, is very involved community, is very connected, and has been doing well. And now Maggie will continue.
I'm also a 7th grade representative. So to add on to Claire, our school has also done activities like the 5th and 6th grade socials. As a school, we try to have all of our students become friends and peers. An idea for our social is going bowling. Bowling is a great idea, and it's a great way for the 5th and 6th graders to socialize. Clink is known as a competition in our school. Every class has clink bags in their classroom. And the competition part is they throw their plastic bottles away, and the class with the most bottles collected gets rewarded a prize. Then the clink bags get transferred to Hannaford Market, where the bags get traded in for money for our school. We then use the money wisely for school supplies and new fun activities. Lastly, the student council throws school dances. The dances happen about every month on a Friday. We try to have fun themes and awesome music for the 7th and 8th graders to enjoy. It costs $5 per person to attend, and we use the money for student council activities, such as Stuff the Bus, as Claire mentioned. These are just a few fun activities our school has put together and are going to do in the future. Thank you for having us and have a great evening.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Moving on to item number 4, comments from the public on agenda items. Are there any members of the public here that would like to step up and comment? Seeing none.
Yes, yes, it's public comment time.
Oh, please. Thank you. I didn't see. Thank you, Heather.
I had a question about why physics is taught in ninth grade, and also because since the that consultant we had last year was discussing, one of his recommendations was that we were moving the math too fast and the children weren't getting a really solid grounding in the math, and the physics in ninth grade needs strong math skills. So if we're slowing down the math, I'm wondering if we're going to be looking again at teaching physics to freshmen. I don't have any more information. That's just a question.
Thank you.
Good question.
Thank you.
May I respond?
Please.
Ma'am, we seriously appreciate your question and your curiosity. Normally we don't respond to questions from the public at that moment at the board meetings. We've got an agenda that we're trying to move with, but your question isn't going to get lost. If the board wishes, this question that you raise can be addressed maybe even at the very next meeting, where we could answer that and perhaps give a larger explanation about the math sequence. So I just don't want you to feel that tonight we don't answer that it was being dismissed. It's not being dismissed. And you certainly aren't alone in asking questions about mathematics and the order of it. So we appreciate it.
Thank you.
I at some point would like to know, not necessarily, but if you want that to be an agenda item, okay, that we would know that so that Kathy and Jeff and others could be prepared to answer it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Are there any other members of the public that would like to speak at this time? Seeing none. Item 5, communications. And we start off with the Tatsky International School in India.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you, school board and Superintendent Coulter, for having us and community members. My name is Holly Forsyth, and I teach third grade at Pond Cove. And I've been asked to be here by Dr. Elena Perez to help introduce our amazing guest teacher here from the Tatsky School in northern India. This is Miss Anugra Rai, and she's a fifth grade teacher there. And my family's had the very good fortune of hosting her in our home. She arrived last week with no luggage, unfortunately, along with three other students. The luggage has happily arrived. She's going to be here until February 3rd, and she'll be working with Talia Edlund at the middle school. We're so fortunate to have Ms. Anugra. We've quickly learned that our passion for teaching and delivery of curriculum is very surprisingly very similar. It's very evident that her passion for teaching is strong, and she's been lucky enough to visit us in Pond Cove as well, so she's getting some varied experience also. She's an excellent cook, and one of our first adventures was to visit Trader Joe's to plan some meals for the week. And I quickly learned that she's an amazing chef and that my family likes authentic Indian food. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce you to Ms.
Good evening, members of Cape Elizabeth School Board. My name is Anugra Rai, and I am the visiting fifth grade teacher from Taxi International School, a small progressive school in the foothills of mountains of northern India. I have been joined by three students from the school, Yantin Namgyal and Rinzing Chingappa, the 11th graders, and Ria Oberoi, a 9th grader. I feel it's extremely important to thank everyone and express my gratitude towards everyone who made this trip possible for us. I would like to thank Cape Elizabeth Board for having us here the second time, Dr. Alina Perez for coordinating this trip, without whom this would not have been possible. The host families who've been generous enough to let us stay at their place and have made us feel at home. And of course, the teachers and students of Cape Elizabeth who've been so welcoming. And in particular, I would like to recognize Mrs. Holly Forsyth in the third grade and Mrs. Edland in the fifth grade. Although it's just been a couple of days I've been here, this trip has been an amazing experience, meeting phenomenal teachers and enthusiastic students. I have been learning how to learn in a culturally different setting. While we all speak English, our perspectives about learning mirror our cultural differences. So my hope is that in these few weeks, we will learn and grow as much as possible, explore, reimagine ourselves, and most importantly, be the window for the students and the teachers of Cape Elizabeth to help get a glimpse of the very culture on the other side of the world, which is diverse and unique in itself, be it the different dialects spoken, colorful traditional dresses, various religious practices, etc. So I would like to take this moment to also invite the students and the teachers of Cape Elizabeth to come visit us and get that first-hand experience of our diverse culture and aggrandize the horizon of their perspectives. This is my first trip to the US and outside India. Ever since I heard about the trip, my mind has been preoccupied with several battling thoughts. I had real close encounters with several feelings, nervousness and apprehensions, but at the same time, excitement and bravery too. My trip thus far has been incredible. It has been a long, tiring journey. It has been an adventure of taking the first few steps in a foreign airport and getting to know that the luggage is still stuck in India. It has been suddenly waking up at 2 in the morning and feeling that it's 8 already. It has been extra responsibility of having 3 students with you in a foreign land. It has been the icy wind and pure white snow that we long to see during our winters. It has been getting to meet the master teachers who also face but similar challenges as I do. It has been making an effort to be a good guest in a different cultural setting, and it has also been a hope of trying to gather seeds of good teaching practices, exchanging ideas, connecting and bonding, learning and growing. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Since Tom is here with his child, shall we move?
Sure.
Okay. At this time, we will love to hear about the Pond Cove STEM field trip proposal.
Hello. Thanks for having us and talking to us about the field trip. Appreciate it. One of the big pushes this year at Pond Cove has been STEM and STEAM, which has been really cool. I've actually added it, kind of not officially, but officially to my title as a STEAM integrator, not just a technology integrator in the building. And we've had a lot of success with it so far in all of the grade levels. Cam Rosenblum and I are doing STEAM with kindergarten right now, which is great. So we're partnering together during their Allied Arts time. First grade has done a STEAM shadow project. Second grade has done 2 great STEAM projects, including one around Halloween that was really, really cool about monsters under bridges. It was all based on a book, which is a nonfiction fiction book, really cool. Third grade has had some STEAM Mondays, where on those half days that we've had, they've done STEAM just all morning long. with their kids, which has been neat. And then there was a lot of STEAM stuff around Egypt as well. In fourth grade, I just got done with Terabucci's class, and we finished up a project with matter. So we found a STEAM project with matter and did some great artwork all around the book, Blueberries for Sal, and how that tied into matter. And so it was really neat. And the artwork was all with different liquids and solids and how they interacted. So with that in mind, Kelly sent me an email, and we've sent that PDF flyer to you as well. But the Red Sox are working with schools and this idea of STEAM and this initiative of STEAM and STEM, and they're having their second annual STEM Day this year. And it's an opportunity for kids from wherever, however they can get there, to come and celebrate STEAM and STEM at Fenway Park, starting at 9 o'clock in the morning, going right up until game time at 1:30. And with a little break for lunch in between. Some of the activities include an egg drop off of the Green Monster, which is amazing. a zoo that they're going to bring in where they do lots of stuff about wildlife and about animals. A STEM fair with all kinds of different sponsors that are there to bring STEM activities, including Google and a couple other things as well. And then the game afterwards. And our thought process was the third group of E-Team members, so back up a little bit here. The E-Team is a group of fourth grade students. It's become kind of like the fourth grade rite of passage for those who want it. When they get to fourth grade, kids in third grade start talking about it in about February, about how excited they are to come and start being on the E-Team. Every year it's gone up. I'm not really sure what we're gonna do if it goes any higher because I've tried to accept every single kid, no matter how many we've had so far. We have three teams, colors, blue, orange, and green, for no reason other than that's what came up. And so this year we have 59 students in fourth grade, which is about 55% of the grade level. And they have to go through an application process. I tell them that I don't necessarily take everybody, and then I take everybody. So you should see it. It's pretty funny. They kind of squirm a little bit before I tell them that they're in. We wanted to incorporate the idea of the STEAM and STEM and also rewarding these kids for their unbelievable work. I don't know if any of you were able to attend the Coder Express. I can see some Pond Cove parents. But this was our fourth annual, and this year it was completely run by those kids from start to finish. And it was amazing. They came up with the idea, they came up with the activities, they came up with the prize that was given away. They ran it all. They decorated it, they did everything. Some of those kids arrived at school at 8 o'clock in the morning to start working with me and did not go home until 8:30 at night. Mm-hmm. And it was unbelievable. And that's only our first night. Our second night's gonna be the exact same thing. This new team is starting to set that up already. And our third night is a STEAM night for our kindergarten and first grade students. So it just kind of lends itself perfectly. So anyways, we gave you all the information. I'm sorry if I'm talking a lot. I believe you should have the flyers about the event, as well as, I don't know if Kelly shared the workbook with you or not, but it's all tied directly into Common Core standards, all through the event. It's a huge opportunity to reward our kids, but also to teach them more about STEM.
Thank you. Tom is the better spokesperson this evening because I have a cold. But we're very happy that you've inserted us in, and we're very happy to answer any questions that you might have about the field trip.
The field trip authorization form that we have is blank.
Oh,
okay. We have nothing.
I've seen one in our email that had stuff filled out.
Mm-hmm. But the hard copy.
So here is.
But you signed this one.
The formatting, I thought I'd only left off one thing, and I sent another email after saying, oh, so sorry, this one is, I don't have copies, but you can pass that around. And then the second page, you got the second page mm-hmm. that answered about the purpose and benefit, mm-hmm. so I'm very sorry that was blank. There was something with the formatting that must have, there was a PDF that you could fill in. So do you want to take a moment to look over the application?
Well, I do have a question about the trip. I think it's fantastic. honestly. I think it's thrilling for the kids who are tapped to go. I'm worried that at 55% of the fourth grade being gone for the day to something wicked super cool, how the other 45% are going to feel.
Call me.
I'll call on you, Tom.
So we were talking about that, actually, and we have decided that all of the sort of activities around this day are all going to be centered around STEM and STEAM. And so we were thinking about this same exact thing, and then we decided that we're actually going to do a bunch of research, find some STEM and STEAM activities that are either similar to what they're doing at Fenway that day, or are STEM and STEAM activities that are along with the curriculum. I'm gonna find those, get all the resources that are needed, all the materials that are needed, all the lesson plans that are needed, and give them to the fourth grade teachers for that day. So thank you for letting me take your kids. Here are these plans, all completely, perfectly folded and copied and everything else that comes with it. Have a great day of doing this kind of a thing. Thanks for letting me take your kids. It was gonna be like I used to teach fourth grade in Las Vegas, and I was kind of thinking the same thing. Like, okay, there go half of my kids. What now? And so I figured I'll take the time from my tech integrator, STEAM integrator title, find them the resources, find them the materials, and now they can say, oh, awesome, I've got something to do this day, and it lends itself exactly to what we're doing and what we want as the message of STEAM.
I appreciate that you've considered the perspective of a classroom teacher who's now left with, you know, half a class.
Absolutely.
My major concern is for the families and the kids who aren't going to go to Fenway Park and watch a ball game. I just, from historically in a district this size, when we've done things that are only applied that are really wicked cool for half a population, the half of the population that doesn't get to participate, there's just, we've had history of there being unhappy people, especially for the other kids who can't go and how their families might feel about that. So that is my major concern, and I think it's great that you're considered about what to do with the teachers in the classroom that day, but I'm wondering if you've thought about the perspective of the kids left behind.
Or is it possible to bring everybody who wants to go?
Yes, and sure. And if that's the direction that would be most beneficial, that we think would work, then yes. This, to me, really felt like an opportunity to reward those kids again for the time that they put in. And I don't want
to
exclude anyone.
I totally get
that.
And I don't want to diminish the reward aspect for their really hard work. But I'm not quite sure from the perspective of a 10-year-old they would understand that.
So part of the challenge is when they signed up for E-Team, they sort of knew what it was going to be.
Yep.
And if everyone knew that this was part of the deal from the beginning and it was transparent and visible, I don't think you'd have the same issue. And so now it's sort of added on later, and it's like, well, maybe I would have signed up, or maybe it would have been a day. Mm-hmm. And so it doesn't. It creates that issue. And so while I understand that E-Team is open to everybody, and this is open to all E-Team, that it does have a challenge of sort of dividing the group about something. And partly also my other hesitation is that I really feel like STEAM is one of those things for everybody, not just people who self-identify. And so that's my second concern, is that, you know, I want as many possible steeped in it. And so I think it's a great opportunity. I'm not sure it fits in as a reward piece at this point, but I think it'd be worth thinking about how can you do this in a way that is more egalitarian for the school. Because I think you would have some legitimate just sort of, that's not what I understand, how I'm now outside and I would have liked to have been inside. So
thank you, because we have talked about this a lot, and we weren't, because the opportunity didn't come up to us until it was actually December 14th, it was sent to me from the Maine Principals Association, so we didn't have any idea about it, and so trying to think, okay, how could we make this affordable, what could we do, and we came up with the idea of the E-Team, but I totally hear you as far as if if children had known in advance, and this is the first year, so this could be something moving forward. Now they do know, and oh, this involves us, we do agree with you. You can hear about everyone should be involved in STEM and STEAM, and it shouldn't be exclusive. So we certainly can redo this and make it for everybody and figure out cost. The cost of the students, if you haven't seen coming around, the cost of the students is about $20. The tickets range from $10 to $18. And transportation, we were going to pay for it with school funds that we have. So we can go back and take a look at that. If that would be desirable, we'd be happy to do that.
I could have
the will of the board.
Yeah, I mean, you could have the added bonus of other kids who might not necessarily have discovered STEM and STEAM. Mm-hmm. For them, this could open that.
So are you proposing that the entire fourth grade go, or that the entire school go?
I didn't have
go?
Necessarily a proposal, not the whole school. I think that might be a bit burdensome, but I'm
fourth,
just...
Fourth grade.
To me, in my mind, this starts to get to the level of the sixth grade Chewonky trip. Mm-hmm. It is really cool. Mm-hmm. And it's experiential, and it's, I think, goes along with a lot of the goals that we want to achieve for our district, too. And to not offer that really great opportunity to everybody or nobody, kind of like if you bring a piece of gum to class, you have enough for everybody, or you don't enjoy your gum if you chew gum in class. But you know what I mean?
One thing to know that's not part of the purpose and benefit rationale is the tickets are first come, first serve, and they have not yet gone on sale. And I spoke with a gentleman in the Red Sox organization yesterday, and he said he can't reserve tickets for me, nor did I ask. Mm-hmm. But he said they're going on sale in a couple of weeks. If I give him the numbers ahead of time, he will then, as soon as they go on sale, he will notify me so that, and I've spoken to Catherine Messmer, our business manager, all about how would that work. Parents, and then any students who could not afford it, we would make sure that we communicate that very well. If this is a hardship for your family, the school would pay the cost of tickets for students.
So logistically speaking, because of the time frame, and the reason why this is in communications and not an action item is the board does not need to approve this field trip. And so as far as being nimble and being able to, you know, recalculate your numbers and your costs and that sort of thing, if you want to offer this to the entire fourth grade, which without voting I feel like is the will of the board, that's something for you and Howard to work out, and you don't have to wait for the February business meeting. That
It can happen fast.
But Barbara?
Just a quick question. Is there any indication from the Red Sox organization or the sponsors of this part of it that this might become kind of an annual event?
The second one.
The second one?
Yes, this is the second one.
I was just going to say, for your emphasis on STEM and STEAM and the sort of buildup, this could sort of be the fourth grade adventure as a culmination of their STEM studies to be able to go to Fenway and participate in this. You could start building that in as a fourth grade sort of rite of passage. Might be pretty exciting.
We have discussed that, yeah. Mm-hmm. It's it would be a great opportunity. And we were surprised. How did we miss the first one? So when it said second.
I'm a little
so.
Worried about April 6th in Fenway.
It'll be chilly.
Could be snowing, or
no,
it could be
such
70.
Thing as bad weather, just bad clothing.
That's right.
They did tell me no matter what the weather. He said rain. If it's they've made accommodations for if it's rain, it will not impact the students' experience. It will impact if there's a game or not. So
right,
no control over that.
Right. So I did
Thank
just.
You.
I'm sorry. I did just run a back of the napkin calculation. So at 139 students registered in our fourth grade at approximately $20 a head is $2,700, which are.
Oh, sorry. That's really.
Yeah.
Is that a fourth grade? Really?
Yes.
Wow.
Well, according to our report.
Yep.
So, and then the. But that's mostly covered through parent contribution. And then there's a line in the budget, I'm assuming, for class trip bus fare
coverage?
There is. We because this would be more expensive, the transportation is the most expensive cost for us, so we would just recalculate and look at other sources that we can.
Yeah,
we did not. We decided not to do any fundraising.
Figure it out.
Yeah, we'll figure it out.
Okay.
Well, that was.
Oh, January. It's not January 2016?
Like, there's no way. Declan's class is one of the smallest.
Okay.
But anyway, moving on.
I'm sorry, I was reading the 2016 number.
Yep.
Because it's not that anymore. Sorry to cut you off. Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you for bringing this opportunity forward and.
We love to. Can you bring back pictures?
You're all invited if you can. First come, first serve.
Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you so much.
I should use my glasses.
All right, I wouldn't have cut that either.
So moving on to item 5A. Just a little discussion about the resource officer.
Yes, I had, as you know, we've been having meetings about a emergency response plan update for our school district. And recently, in conversations with police chief and actually also with some of our principals, there was questions came about, do we feel that there is any interest now in the police department initiating a grant to fund for a couple of years a school resource officer, someone who would be somewhat itinerant, not be placed at one school, but would travel around the schools during the day, and that would be during the school year, his or her full-time job, or their primary job. And then in the summer months, they would be able to be on the police force doing other work for the town. The question was, is there enough interest in this that it would be worth beginning to put together the plans for a grant? I mean, if there isn't, why waste anyone's time? There is a gentleman who currently is a police officer in town who, in fact, does spend a good part of his time during the school week visiting schools. As far as I know, and I've been told by principals, they and students and teachers feel comfortable with an officer being in the building and rather enjoy the that relationship. But this is nothing that I feel is for me to say yes, go forward and begin to propose a grant. I want to be sure that we have this conversation and feel.
Bless you.
If you have feelings one way or the other, I'd love to know what they are so that I can get back to Neil and let him know what your thoughts are.
I have to jump right out of the gate and say, for years I've always been a fan of having school resource officers on campuses in the schools. I think that it builds a healthy relationship between young people and law enforcement. My relationship with law enforcement, having worked with them for a number of years in the past, is they are of utmost concern for the safety and welfare of kids. And I think that forming those bonds is a really smart move. Officer Gavin, I believe, is the officer who's currently serving as sort of a liaison between the police department and the school department, is an incredibly affable, likable young gentleman. And my experience with these types of grants, they come with specific training for the officers who are designated on this grant funding to actually learn how best to serve as a school resource officer within a school district. You are really serving more as a social worker than you are as a law enforcement officer under those circumstances. So I'm all for it.
I think it would be really important for a lot of people to have a clear delineation of duties. Mm-hmm. So that they understand that the resource officer is not taking the place of administration when it comes to situations or discipline or that sort of thing, that
right.
as soon as they are involved, it's theirs and it's not right. ours anymore. Right. And it's not necessarily a concern of mine. I feel incumbent to share concerns that have been expressed by former board members and other community members that was a concern for myself. I see incredible benefits, and I have worked in school systems with really positive outcomes with school resource officers. And Barbara probably remembers and I don't know if Rob Susie is still there, but...
Still there?
Mm-hmm. Amazing connections. I had his daughter as a tennis player, and so got to know him, and he couldn't talk enough about his students. Mm-hmm. He wasn't there as a police officer. He was there, you know, to help, and he coached and...
Just make... Work out in the weight room. And,
right, and just really be a really positive
presence. The other thing that I really appreciated with him, as does all of Falmouth, is his absolute commitment to keeping the emergency plan in terrific shape and offering school-to-school training at the start of every school year, coming, you know, handling any drills, being the liaison with the police department. They did some really progressive things in Falmouth between the schools and the police around first offense issues regarding alcohol. I mean, there's just there's a whole area of growth there for us, I think, might be made possible.
What's the current state of the, what is the current role that, or exposure, or, you know, you said, is he there now? So I'm just curious, like,
how's working now?
How will it feel different to the students? If, you know, if we do, from now
to... The question, I think, is...
What does Officer Gavin do now?
Yeah, what does Officer Gavin do now?
He shows up and talks to kids. Yeah. That's what he does.
Like how often?
I'm thinking, I typically see him once a week or so in the high school. He's very often, not to typecast police officers, but he's often, very often, he shows up on days when we have bake sales. not so much to eat he probably gives donations to the kids, but because there are kids there and he engages them in conversation. But he roams the hallways and he's sometimes down in the cafeteria. He just shows up and he talks to kids. He is called upon from time to time by either our government teacher or our health teacher sometimes to do presentations in classes, and does a really nice job. I think kids really enjoy and respect him and enjoy talking to him. And school resource officer, its success is highly dependent on the person that you get. Yeah. It's almost entirely dependent on the person 100%. You get. So my concern if we go this route would be just to make sure that we have a strong say in along with the police chief and who is selected to serve in this role if we were to get a grant.
So I guess what I'm curious about is, you know, how different will it feel to the students, and does he already do, whether it's the same person or not, but do the students already, would they feel like it's not that different if we do go with this program? And does it happen at Pond Cove, and would it happen at Pond Cove?
So I guess my feeling is, and then Mike can talk about the middle school experience, is that at the especially because we're talking about a school resource officer who would be going from building to building to building, there wouldn't be a sense that the person is in any one building all the time. So in that sense, I don't think it would be particularly different. Mm-hmm. I think it would just be more of a presence and more frequent presence, mm-hmm. but I don't think it's anything that students would react to in a negative way at all. In fact, I think, based on my experience, watching the interactions, it would be quite the opposite.
I did some of my best nodding behind Jeff. I hope you noticed. I agree with everything that Jeff said, and I'll include Kelly as well. But I think the difference would likely be imperceptible to the students, other than I believe we'd have an opportunity to see the officer more. Mm-hmm. And I really would echo and emphasize what Principal Shedd said about it having to be the right person who really understands the developmental levels of the students and young people that they'd be working with. So it's been absolutely entirely positive experience for us having the community liaison officer visiting with us. I think this would add a level of having it really be integrated into the fabric of our school.
And I agree with both my colleagues, everything both of them said. With Pond Cove, Officer Galvin has been a wonderful presence, and our students really do see him as part of the community. what the one thing that initially came up was questions from parents. Parents would say, why is there a police officer here? So we simply put his picture in a newsletter and said, we want to introduce Officer Galvin to you and just what his purpose was in the building, and that took care of that. So we found it to be a very, very positive experience.
Thank you. I'm glad to hear that it's not going to be anything that we have to explain, especially to the younger kids, like why all of a sudden there's an officer there. So I'm glad to hear that it's going to be a very small difference.
So,
perception.
So I'm generally supportive, particularly of having a resource officer in Pond Cove in the middle school. I think from an institutional point of view, if you're going to have a regular official presence of a police officer in your high school, I think we do need to think a little more carefully about that. Those are students who are approaching adulthood and have more privacy and other concerns that are not nearly as present at the same degree as you would find at Pond Cove in the middle school. And I think that the high school in particular is a much trickier ground to navigate in terms of having an official regular police presence. And I think we'd want to think carefully about what the role is there and how to define that, because I think you do start to run afoul of those if you're not careful. And I think we have some policies that sort of talk about our relationship with the police department, they work very hard on those, and I would want to make sure that whatever we're doing meshes with that. And I think it carefully navigates through some of that thorny territory.
So maybe Barbara or Joe or Howard, people who've had experience with this, can illuminate a little.
What I would suggest is that if it's true that there's general openness to the possibility of a school resource officer, that I would ask Neil, the police chief, to please draft the grant proposal, and he and I could work on what I refer to as a memorandum of understanding that would nail down some of the details about the things that are being raised tonight. Bring that to you for your review and discussion before it goes any further. So you see some of this spelled out, and the things that still remain of concern, we can address those next. So that be okay?
Is that does the timeline allow for that?
Oh yes.
Great. Okay. Yeah. That would be great. Yep.
Okay. So thank you.
Thank you for bringing that to our attention.
Next up in communications, we have the 2017-2018 school year calendar. Just in communications, first read.
Okay, so notes. So we put together a committee this year, really a great committee of we had parents, we had teachers, we had administrators, we had board members. We had central office administrators. A lot of people were involved and came together over, I think, 3 months working on this. It doesn't look like it. Maybe it's that complicated, but I think we finally were just exhausted and quit. And what we tried to do was to think of several things. One is we didn't want we wanted to start the year off on good footing for teachers to have time to get ready and to work at the school level and a bit of district level work, but just have time in their classroom and get themselves all situated, and that's what we see at the very beginning of this proposal. We also recognize there's a lot of work to be done in aligning our curriculum and also working toward being a district that's proficiency-based in terms of education, but also the requirement of demonstrating certain levels of proficiency in order to earn a high school diploma in 4 years from now. So we recognize that just takes a lot of work, and it can't all be done. Put it in a positive way. It needs to be done in a way that allows teachers to get together within a building and between buildings to work. So after looking at any number of options, the final proposal, which you see here, is that there are a number of days spread out through the entire year where school is letting out early, not that early. It isn't like a half day early release, but a bit early, and teachers are going to spend that hour or so after students leave, plus an additional hour of time that's part of their overall professional work year on getting together and doing that work. So that's very exciting. I must say, it wasn't easy to even get to that point, because to the credit of our teachers and administrators, people are concerned about any loss of instructional time. And even an hour is, it's still an hour. And an hour every often, over time, adds up. And so there's concern about that, and this seemed to be kind of the compromise, because at one point we were talking about half days. And so we think this is, good middle ground. You can see that we've got a fairly early ending date for the school year, which was another goal that we had. Thank you. What is the ending date here? Is it June?
It looks like
the 11th. Is that without snow days?
Yes.
I'm not sure. This isn't a complete. It's not. I can't. But I can't read it really
that's
well.
Without snow
I think
days.
Before
that's the 175 yes. without snow days.
175 is 11. Okay.
So
I think when we approve, we'd prefer probably this format so we can have a better.
Right. So anyway, we're feeling good about this. I don't know. Others of you were on that committee. Does anybody want to add to what I've said that helps others? Point out the differences in what's proposed versus what we have currently in place.
Did you want to say something about the election
day? Thank you. So
but I wanted to point out, because I wasn't at the last meeting, so I guess I feel a concern around November.
Yeah, I sure
November looks
too.
Yes, scary. Yep. I don't like it.
So back up, if you remember, we came into this year without Election Day being, a school day, and then there was a proposal from the town side to change that. And in fact, the last couple of biennial elections, the congressional elections, basically, we have had school off for the last couple of years. So in anticipation of the fact that that's probably going to be a recurring request, and it certainly does serve some good purposes, there was a lot of discussion on the committee about what to do with parent-teacher conferences. So in the end, sort of the recommendation, as reflected in this calendar, is that the 7th would be, November 7th, which would be Election Day, would be a day off, except for teachers. And parent-teacher conferences would be organized around that week that begins November 6th and ends on November 11th. And different schools would do it slightly differently, just as we have successfully, I think, in a way that works for parents, because it spreads conferences out, and it does means parents aren't being pulled in all three schools at once. So it allows the flexibility to do it. So essentially what it does is it shifts conferences which have traditionally been late October, one or 2 weeks later, depending on where Election Day is in any given year. Does that work? Okay.
Thank you for explaining. Appreciate it.
So the question, though, is this coming November, this will be November 2017, is an off-year election. Do we really anticipate the need to close the school?
So the thought of the committee was that it may be helpful for parents to get used to the idea that this we just do this all the time. So we don't have to sort of reinvent it every year. That was the thinking of the committee after lots and lots and lots of discussion. So whether it's the right, but anyway, that was the recommendation.
Okay. And so I just wanted to ask, and I was on the committee, but I wasn't there for the last day. So was there an agreement? Are all schools having an early release on the 6th, or is that going to be spread around differently? Do you know what I mean?
I know that the way the high school would do it would be the early release on the 6th.
Okay.
I can't remember.
I think it's all schools.
I'm seeing nodding heads from the other administrators.
All schools will have an early release on the 6th, and then a full day on the 7th.
Yes, so the trade-off of that day, and the committee did talk about this, is that particular week becomes a pretty chopped up week because the 11th, the Friday, at least next year, the Friday is Veterans Day. So.
Did the committee have any discussion around the early release PD days in November, given the?
No, so I remember during the.
Really?
Yeah, and I remember this was happening towards the very end of the final meeting that we had. And as I look at this now, and I'm looking in April and February, there's only two dates, February 7th and April 4th, where we have the early release for professional development. So maybe during the month of November, we could not have the early release for the 15th. I am a huge proponent of these early release days, but for November, perhaps it could just be the 1st and let the 6th and 7th sort of take that space and have a regular school day so that there's at least 1 week, the week of the 13th being a full week of school, and finding some compromise there.
I have to echo you on that, that I'm a huge proponent of these early release days for giving teachers the time that they've been really begging for to, they just don't have the time to do the work that needs to be done, and it's a lot
the time
of it
that
is,
they need.
And I don't want to be kind of negative about, but some of this work is kind of the grunt work. It's not necessarily the exciting work that they want to do, but by doing this twice monthly, then there's time to grind out this work and have some of this very fulfilling, enriching professional development for them to do, where they, you know, can actually hone and explore their practice. So I am super excited about this, but have to, you know, November, I don't love it.
It's way too broken up.
I think if we look at the April and the February, that November might follow suit.
Can I also ask, do I only see conferences once a year?
In the fall? I don't see any spring conferences.
I think there was a proposal to absorb so high school doesn't conference in the spring, is my understanding. Am I getting this right? Middle school already absorbed a lot into mornings in, am I right, Mike, that middle school did some conferencing, but it didn't have days off for it. So, and then elementary only had an early release anyway for spring conferences. So can someone remind me what we, did we build that into one of these? Okay, yeah.
We said that they would have the flexibility to choose either the 7th or the 21st for conferences in March.
Instead of professional development?
PONCO would opt.
Okay, PONCO.
PONCO only, because they're the school that traditionally has the early release for conferences in spring, that they would select one of those two. They reserve the right to select one of those two early release afternoons to use for conferences instead of PD.
So I have, and thank you, because I knew there was something like that. So a comment, when we have this on our agenda for approval, what would be really helpful would be to have a little bit fuller explanation so that the public can understand and we can understand where the conferences are built in and that sort of thing, so it's a little bit more robust.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Sorry, were you still going?
May I finish?
Yes, sorry.
Sure.
I thought you were done.
And then I just want to check back in, because we had heard from middle school teachers that they would love to move their spring conferences earlier.
That's
to suit. Okay.
I think, if I'm correct,
that right, Mike?
Mike, that the 7th of February we said the same thing that we're talking about for the 7th or the 14th for Pond Cove conferences would be for middle school conferences,
because
if I'm remembering that correctly. So that would be, instead of professional development day for the middle school, it would be conference
because
opportunity.
They wanted to be able to work on placement
for high school.
Is that? They wanted it earlier.
Mm-hmm. Question. And I don't have one in front of me, I apologize. Current calendar have 175 student days and 183 teacher days? Those seem low to me.
It's right here.
Yes?
I think so. Yep.
Okay. Just my wondering is about the, with the conference time, the early release gives teachers 2 hours, and elementary and middle school people see a lot more than four parents and or six parents in 2 hours. I'm just wondering about the rest of the conference time and whether there was some comp time built in from one of the other teacher days, let's just say. Just a thought to give some flexibility. Kelly? For the conference day?
Mm-hmm. On Wednesday, March 21st.
Mm-hmm. So that I remember that.
A full half day as they're going to use to for conferences in the spring.
Mm-hmm. So I think it would be important, perhaps, in that a request that I made that maybe doesn't, that's not just, you know, a yellow, maybe that's a green and that's a noon, you know, that sort
mm-hmm.
of thing.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, thank you.
So, did you want to see something different in the next next month regarding the November?
I think November.
What do you want that to look like?
Heather's proposal was that we scratch the 15th and make that a full school week. Was that, am I?
Yes, correct? That's what I was suggesting, yes.
So that at least there's one full school week. And Kathy doesn't look horrified.
On November 15th?
Yeah. Right.
Not this date.
That these, everything else stands, but kind of mirroring the way we're doing it in February and April, that since there's so much school off already, that we just have one early release for the PD.
So 15th is a full day.
Turn it into a full day.
I do have one last question. Whether the committee considered, instead of two half days a month, whether they considered having one full day a month off, and how that shook out, if you had that conversation.
Yeah. I think there were two reasons for that. One is that when you have just one a month, there's a large amount of time in between, longer time frame, and it's harder to get the ball rolling again, and the time isn't used as effectively, and that when you go in and you take some smaller chunks, it can be utilized really effectively, really well, as opposed to the whole day, which can be overwhelming. And it was working to not keep the kids out of school all day long. We thought an hour early release would have less impact than a full day off. Does that
right?
I believe yep. that model to push out your school year a good number of days as well.
Right.
Okay.
Yeah.
So is the 6th of November an early release, as in the Pond Cove gets out at 2:15, or is that a noon dismissal in preparation for conferences?
They get out here.
Noon.
And then this is when they start conferencing.
Should be a different color, I'd say, and a different.
So wait, they get out
at 1:50.
So that they get out at 1:50?
So they really release at 1:50 and then
conference, but they do the professional development days.
During these hours.
Which brings me to my last question. So it's a 1:50 dismissal, or whatever. It's not a noon dismissal for the conference time. Yeah, but it's not an earlier, as we talked here, that there was an earlier dismissal in March. November does not have an earlier dismissal.
Well, I think because they have birthday on Tuesday.
Right, no, I was just conferring. I was wondering then in conjunction if there was any discussion of having a full day off on that Monday as opposed to having the conferences. Jeff, did you say that this November schedule allows for a little bit more space for conferences? Did you say something like that?
Yeah, November just looks...
No. Not like just more spread out for all, you know, like let's say parents have kids in all three schools.
Because each of the schools, even though it's designated exactly the same amount of conferences, because each of the schools historically has done their conferences a little bit differently,
segment, an afternoon segment, an evening segment, so it can accommodate different parents' needs, depending on what their family, how their family works. But really what happens at Pond Cove and the middle school, when Kelly and Mike would be able to have to talk more specifically, they actually spread their conferences out more than the course of that entire week. So it should be, it's always, and that's the way it's happened for a long time, and it should be manageable, and I believe it always happened to the parents. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. No, I just, for some reason, I thought you said somehow this system was building in more additional conference time, but it's not, right?
So I would like to thank the committee members that came together to work on this. It was a really positive working group, and it took a lot of, these don't sound like huge changes, but they're big changes to build these sort of traditions in of giving teachers time to do the work that they need to do, that they're told from the state and the government that they have to do, as well as the work that they want to do to improve their practice. So it took a lot of work, and I'm just so grateful to everybody that participated in this.
Me too.
All the building principals kept going back and getting feedback from their staff and really represented well. And so we thank you. We thank everybody for this.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah. So we'll probably see this as an action item.
Mm-hmm. Next month.
Wow. Exciting.
It's great.
Can we have just one?
We also sent this to the state through our county, the superintendents, and the state is satisfied that we're within the limit
That's what I was going to ask. That's great. Mm-hmm. And our students that attend PATHS are in morning session there, correct?
Our students in PATHS are in the
afternoon
session. Most.
Mm-hmm.
Most mm-hmm.
Okay. And I would love to hear when we do final vote how you might, because let me step back 1 second. So I'm a huge proponent of this as well. Regular, early release time, shorter chunks. You can plan it intensively. Full days, never give us 6 hours of full day. You just can't.
Never used well.
You just can't stick right with something that long. But just sort of a sense of if you're going to slightly squish your periods on those, you know, there's class periods on those Wednesdays, how you're going to kind of run the school, that would be really helpful to know.
I can do that now if it's helpful. We talked this morning with administration and some teacher representatives about what may be best practice for us. And given the number of times this will happen, which would be 16, there was a preference shared that it's better to continue to be able to see all of your classes on a regular basis.
Shorter time.
So we would see every class each of those days for just shorter periods is what will likely be the middle school solution.
Mm-hmm.
We are in discussion.
Okay.
So.
Okay, thank you.
I just want to thank the calendar committee for their hard work. This is the thing that puts some teeth into actually walking the walk, what we believe in professional development. It's one of those things that always seems to, in our past, has gotten pushed to the side. It has tremendous value. It has cumulative value. And if you say that it's important, but you don't make space for it, it gets pushed aside by things that are urgent. So this is our way of making those important things have some urgency and consistency and follow through to them. And I think that we'll see a significant cumulative benefit over time to changing the structure where we get the work done that needs to get done to improve and unify instruction. It's not happening currently to the level it needs to.
Thanks, Joe. Further discussion? Thanks.
Moving on to the Cape Elizabeth High School Program of Studies for 2017-2018. Just a first read. Mr. Shedd, you're going to talk to us about a small comprehensive.
No, that's the budget discussion. No, I probably won't even mention that phrase.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to.
Unless somebody prompts it with a question, it might come out. So, okay, so this is the draft program of studies. And there are some, I will say it up front, I'm not going to review, there are some typos in here, and there's some very minor word change tweaks that will be happening here. So if you have read this one comprehensively and you read another one comprehensively, hopefully we will clean things up. I do want to point out on page 3, there definitely will be a change, a meaningful change, and it was just my oversight. So on page 3, we introduce the idea of proficiency-based diplomas because that really kicks in with our beginning ninth graders next year. And I made a mistake in this. So the second paragraph talks about for the class of 2021, which is next year's ninth graders, the two subject areas in which graduates must demonstrate proficiency are English and math. That was my mistake, operating from memory. Next year's ninth graders actually need to demonstrate proficiency in English, math, science, and social studies by the time they graduate. And that will be changed. That will be changed when this becomes a final document. Mm-hmm. So I wanted to point that out because that is a very substantive change. So in terms of other changes to the program of study, they really are quite minor. Under the math sequence, and this actually relates a little bit to what Ms. Mikulko was talking about. So under the math sequence, the algebra part 1 and 2 classes, you won't see them, so don't look for them. Because they're not there. They have traditionally been a part of our curriculum. They are not this year, but we are sort of adjusting to some curricular changes in the grades before us, so those classes are not there for next year. They're actually not offered this year either, just because of course signups and the recommendations and the way they came to us. So that's one thing. The other thing is, again, under math, you will see, and I should have flagged these pages for me, on page 20, you will see a new course. Now, this course is actually being offered this year, but it was added to the program of studies after all the students had enrolled for classes because we were going through a process of discussion with Southern Maine Community College. This is a class, it is a concurrent enrollment class, so students take quantitative reasoning. It's almost all seniors. They take quantitative reasoning. It follows the curriculum of an SMCC class by the same name, and the students who pass this class, if they fulfill the requirements, they get not only high school credit, but they also get SMCC's college credit for it as well. And it's been a very positively received class. Students really enjoy it. It has a much more practical flair, but it still really tests kids' ability to think mathematically, apply mathematical skills, and those sorts of things. So that's a new class that I wanted to point out. And under the science offerings, which I think is after math, I just saw it, and now I'm not seeing it.
It's right after math.
Oh, okay. I've got science. I just hadn't found the particular course. On page 21, you will notice VEX Robotics. So what we're doing with VEX Robotics, and in large part, it is made possible by the transition of what had been the lecture hall / ATM room / various other names into a robotics classroom. So we are bringing robotics into the school day. It will also continue as a team and extracurricular activity after the school day, but we are introducing a VEX Robotics course. And essentially what this does is it introduces kids to robotics who may be interested in it. It's a way to see if it's something that they enjoy, and it also, for those students who choose, it prepares them to be part of the extracurricular, one of the extracurricular teams that high school students have an opportunity to participate in. So I think that is exciting. There is also under science another error which will be removed, but I wanted to point it out to you. So on page 21, there is reference to the a proposal that will be made to the board as it gets through the policy concerning graduation requirements, and this is related to proficiency diplomas, main learning results, and those sorts of things. So one of the the science department will be proposing a required senior year experience / class in Earth and Space Science. Right now, Earth and Space Science exists in the high school as a popular elective, but it is not a required class, which means the students who leave Cape Elizabeth High School right now leave without a real unless they take that class, many leave without an exposure to Earth science and an exposure to space science, both of which live within the main learning results. So that is a proposal that will come before the board. I think the board, the policy committee, in the near future is going to be looking at graduation requirements. So the language of this on page 21 that you see where it definitively says that there will be a course added that will be introduced as a possibility that there was a proposal that this might be true by the time these students become seniors, but it's not true yet. So that will be, that language will be modified. There are three added new classes that we're putting into the program of studies to see if they attract interest, enough interest to offer them as courses. One is a semester elective in social studies in sociology. And that would be open to students in 9 through 12. It's a very common elective, social studies elective in a lot of schools, so that's that. Under the fine arts, there are two classes, when you get a chance to look through this in more detail, that we are adding into the program of studies. And one is, one would have a budget implication, and you'll hear about it through the budget process. Whether or not it turns into reality would depend on sign-ups and whether or not it gets approved through the budget process. But one is the addition of a treble choir. So right now we have a very small, undeveloped choral music program. And there is one concert choir which is open to all students. And our choral music, and that is all we have. So the idea is to provide an opportunity for students who want to take their music, their singing experiences in a more deep and serious way. Not that concert choir isn't serious, it is, but if they want to develop those skills at a deeper, higher level, treble choir provide an opportunity to do this. If this flies, both from a budgetary standpoint and a student sign-up standpoint, it would not be new to the high school. It was a mainstay in the high school for many, many years, until we went through a period of time where just for staffing reasons, we had a lot of changes in our choral music program, and one of the consequences was that the sign-ups gradually dwindled, which is unfortunate because it's a wonderful outlet for kids. I believe there will be enough students to justify that. It would be added as a junior, it would be open to juniors or seniors. And the other class that is in the program of studies that may or may not have budgetary implications depending on course signups is in the visual arts. You will see that there is the addition of a sculpture elective class. So right now the only 3D art class that we offer at the high school is ceramics. And the idea is to offer an elective in sculpture, which allows the teacher and the students to branch out in the media, the physical stuff they're using to create 3D artistic creations. And so that's that idea. And I think that's it. You will also see, it's not really a new course, but some board members remember that yearbook used to be a class, We changed it to an elective, to an extracurricular activity, which it is now, and it's doing well in. But we did add to the program of studies, there would be zero budgetary implications to it, but we added as the name of a course, an opportunity for a few students if they're interested, and when you come across it, you'll see it's called Yearbook Leadership. So the idea is up to three students could take, act as a leader with the after-school extracurricular yearbook club and get academic credit for that through their participation in that leadership opportunity, because it's a huge enterprise to create a yearbook. It is really a business enterprise, and there are tremendous leadership roles, opportunities that are there for students. So that's the idea for that. And I don't know if anybody had any other questions. You will continue to see Freshman Academy. You'll continue to see student-driven learning in here. Those changes, nothing new, yes?
I actually did. I'm glad you brought those to student-driven learning and Freshman Academy up. I actually couldn't find them in, because they don't fall neatly under English.
Yeah, I think they're in the introductory things.
Right, like the fourth page.
So student-driven learning is on page 5. And I know Freshman Academy is in here as well, because I saw it.
Well, if you, I'm not.
If it is not okay, here, I'm almost positive it is.
Under support services.
Is it? What page is that?
12.
Say that again.
12.
Well, thank you.
It's 12. Freshman Academy. There it is. Thank you.
Yep.
And then the other question I had was about the treble choir.
Yes.
I think that's an amazing opportunity. There are a number of incredibly talented, I would say, artists in our community in general, from the jazz musicians straight on to the vocalists who study. I'm wondering if having the treble choir only available to juniors and seniors, when I have seen a number of very talented young 14-year-olds also in our district, if it, and also for the numbers that you might need, whether opening that.
So here's the, right, and it's a good question. Here is the trade-off. Concern would be we want to make sure that we continue to offer a choral music opportunity for all students, for anybody who is interested in choral music, including guys, because treble choir would be all girls.
Oh, I didn't understand that part.
Well, I'm sorry.
Just
the treble choir is all girls, and I could explain the reason for doing that as a first effort to try to build our choral music program. But what we don't want to do is kill the concert choir. And I think if we offered treble choir as an opportunity for anybody, I think there would be a serious risk that we would kill our concert choir. So it's, but you raise a, I mean, we've talked about it, and that's the resolution that we've come to as a way to introduce it. I wouldn't be surprised if, depending on the signups, as long as we see that concert choir is still a viable opportunity, and there's some students who have some particular expertise, talent, interest, passion, that I wouldn't be surprised if we alter that a little bit. But as a beginning point, we basically, it's in there as 11th and 12th grade only to try to prevent the, because our concert choir is also very low in numbers, and it is particularly very low in numbers of guys. Yep.
I have a couple comment questions.
Sure.
Back to page 3, this is just where it says in the first paragraph that
yes.
Main learning's results and specific methods of proving learning consistent with those standards is up to each individual school district subject to the state's approval. Didn't we apply and get approved that already? That's my recollection.
Yep. I think what you're remembering accurately is that we applied 2 years ago, I think, for an extension of time within which to do the preparatory work we needed to do before we did a full implementation of proficiency diplomas. But our request for additional time was not, here's the plan that we're going to do, specifically, substantively, how it's going to work. It was, as in virtually every school district in the state got an extension, by the way, there's only a very tiny handful who did not.
It was something else. I thought it was something about, I can't remember the saying, but something about where, just like it says here, that the actual requirements can be determined by the school itself. And I thought we applied for that.
Is that the innovative school district?
Maybe that was it. Maybe that was it.
I spoke to State Ed about the test. Is that what you're referring to, the actual test?
No. I think it's the innovative school district, I think.
So, if that's what...
I think.
Maybe, I'm not an expert on innovative school district. I know that legally in the statutes there is an opportunity to apply to be an innovative school district, which actually then, if any school district were to do that, they could ask for permission to have certain state requirements waived, including, I think, things like proficiency-based education and probably some other things as well. But we did not end up applying for that.
Okay. Susan? All right. I think I'm confused then. Then my other comment and question, first question, in the section of under alternative pathways.
Yes.
In particular, in the independent studies, but I'm also wondering the same question for the other courses listed in this section. In the independent study program, it says independent study may not be used to replace a class required for graduation. And why is that, if that's so?
I think the easy answer is, but I'm operating from memory, and my memory may be faulty, is that I think that's school board policy. I think the idea is to take, because understand that independent study is teachers volunteering, essentially, volunteering to work with students on their own time to support a particular area of interest that they have that is not covered by courses that we already offer. So teachers get no additional compensation for that. It's not considered a class assignment. They still continue to teach a full load of classes. So the idea is, if we already offer a course, that students should take that course, and then if there's another area beyond that or some variation of it that they wish to do later on, that they would have an opportunity to take it as an independent study. But again, I think the critical thing to understand about independent study is it is entirely voluntary on the teacher's part to support students in doing that. So because they are already teaching the classes, to have them do an independent study on something that they already teach a class for, it wouldn't be the most exciting arrangement for.
In same question for student-driven learning.
Yep.
Is that a different stipulation then, where it says juniors and seniors earn education credits? Does that mean it does apply to graduation?
Yes, those credits absolutely do apply towards graduation. Okay. Student-driven learning credits absolutely apply to graduation, okay. As do independent study credits as well.
Okay.
Apply to graduation.
Yeah, great. Because I really, my angle is making sure that, it's what we're doing is alternative pathways. So other ways for kids to meet graduation needs other than what we currently offer. So that's where I'm coming from.
Right. And so work study, I totally get what, so independent study is not quite there. If teachers, were given a smaller number of courses to teach, and then did independent studies as well. In other words, that was part of what they were hired to do. Then I think that requirement would not be there. If that's something that the school district wanted to do, then teachers, I think, would be happy to do that.
Then my other comment, I don't know how to deal with this, but it just seems like this alternative pathways, and perhaps even Freshman Academy, but definitely alternative pathways section, should not be so separated from the rest of the curriculum. It feels like it's just, it, I don't know, I'm worried that people are, some students are just going to gloss right over it because they think it's for not them. I'm just wondering why, maybe we should just keep it, you know, in terms of just the order, keep it with everything else.
We can do that. I mean, we ended up putting it in front and center because we wanted to make it more prominent that it was.
And I remember changing that.
Right.
And I'm just wondering why we don't just keep it right here in the front and center, you know, at the beginning of all the course descriptions. But.
We could do that. That's.
I guess that's what I'm.
I see what you're saying. You know, it's.
Put it somewhere in the table of contents.
Make it look just like all the others. Yes.
Yeah, I think we could easily do that. I'd be happy to do that. That's not a problem.
I agree with that. I guess that's why I couldn't find them. They're not really easily found in the table of contents, nor are they listed in the course listings on page 15. Mm-hmm. At least not that I could find.
That's an oversight. We will correct that. Thank you.
I think that would just help, John.
Yep.
So just to get a read on it, what's the current level of participation in independent study? Do you know?
Off the top of my head, I would guess it's maybe a dozen students, but that's strictly your guess, John.
Out of the whole
high school? Yeah, I can find out.
Wow, that seems low to me.
Well, again, understand that it's really, it is really entirely on teachers' own time to support students who come, and students' own time as well, because it's outside of the school day.
The high school is doing what it's doing. My own past experiences with independent study elsewhere is it was a fantastic tool for flexibility, both in terms of scheduling and topic matter. So you could, it wasn't necessarily uncompensated, but it was used as a way to accommodate scheduling conflicts and as well as deeper interests and often more advanced work, and that there was such a high level of participation. It was not all voluntary, in a number of different places that I've seen it. So, and it was. I have seen it used at all levels to be able to customize curriculum and you end up with often really deep student and teacher connections as a result of that, which is something else we're trying to do. So I'm really surprised that it's at the level that it's at. So, and that's, you know, that's what we're doing. So
I would be happy to work up a proposal that would make it look differently.
I'm wondering if student-driven learning doesn't fit that definition.
So if I may interject, since the board just got their hands on this very recently, with your permission, what would be great is if board members wanted to just look through, send any questions my way, and I'll get them to Jeff so that Jeff can have the time to, you know, research and answer them. Since it's just on here for a first read, we're not taking any action tonight. So give everybody some time to really dig in, read. Jeff researches, brings it back to us at the next business meeting. Does that
thank you
comfortable for people?
That's terrific.
That'll be great.
Yeah, no, thank you. Because I didn't know if this was our only shot or
it's
not.
It's not.
No. I knew I was coming back again. No,
dipping our toe in the pool. Just a dip.
Thank you, Jeff.
Great.
Thank you so much. At this time, item 5E, superintendent's report, please.
Okay. let's see. Well, this is a time of the year where teachers who are beginning to give notice of their intent to retire. And this last week, Eric Nielsen, a teacher at Pond Cove, submitted his letter of intent to retire at the end of this year. So I wanted you to be aware of that, and we certainly send him a thank you and congratulations. But again, as they come in, we'll be sure and keep you posted. This last week also received word from the Department of Education that our application that was submitted by Kathy Stankard for Gifted and Talented had been approved and for the current school year, and that was a grant of around just under $30,000, so that was nice to receive, and thank you, Kathy, for writing that grant. Another thing I want to mention is that we have some early release days coming up for students that are at the front end of some times off for vacation weeks. One of them is the 17th of February, and the other one is the 13th of April. And I just don't want you surprised by this. Feeling is that after students leave on the 17th of February, I'm feeling as if it would be well received and appreciated by teachers that they could also head out for their week. And they've been putting in a lot of time. It seems that it would be a nice way to thank them and not try and find something to do that is really going to have their attention at that time of the year, on that day. It just seems like it would be nice to say thank you, and after the kids leave, you're on your way. The 13th of April is a Thursday, I believe, not a Friday. And on that day, they would be, I think the focus would be on their own personal wellness. So a variety of activities will be provided, and teachers would be picking off of a list of things to do, things that they could do to promote their own health and wellness. So that's what will happen on the 13th of April. Another thing I'd mention is that there's a survey that comes out every couple of years. It's the Maine Integrated Youth Health Survey. And it's done every other year, and it's useful if you look at the trend over time of it's a way to measure student behavior and health and how they're feeling, and some very valuable, important questions come out of it. But at some point, you get it that you've got students that have got that are like in all schools that are not getting enough sleep. In some cases, they're smoking marijuana. In some cases, they're drinking alcohol. They aren't eating enough vegetables. They aren't sure how comfortable they are. I mean, there's a trend here. And what I talked about today with Jeff and with Mike is that what we think makes more sense this year is to ask questions that we think are provocative and useful to what we already know about our students. Like an example that came up today in our conversation was, there is some debate going on about is smoking marijuana unhealthy? I mean, there's a debate about that. Does it matter? Who knows? Well, that could be one of the questions that could be asked. What is your opinion about this, as opposed to do you smoke marijuana? And that could lead to some discussions at school between teachers and students and through advisees and advisors or through classes, and have it become more of a useful gathering of information and using it to promote conversation and research and debate among students, as opposed to just saying, well, how do we stack up against X school in terms of how many kids have had more than two beers in the last 7 days? I don't know. At some point, it matters. I mean, you get my point? So I just want you to know,
we've done it for years and years.
There will be some surveying done at middle and high school. I don't know about elementary, and it will be intended to, again, lead to conversation, discussion, and real research and active conversations around these really important subjects. So this is what you know. If we aren't going to be showing up on the list this year, it isn't because we're just trying to dodge it. We aren't. We just think there's a better way to get at these important
issues. So, Howard, are you saying that as a district we have foregone taking the MEHAS?
Well, we are for this year. There was a deadline for application, and that's come and gone, I believe. So rather than doing nothing, I think that the plan is to do what I just said, and to ask some questions that, from what we've seen over time, lead us to why, and what we're, and you know, there's a whole issue right now about legalizing marijuana in Maine, and you know, the debate that's always out there about legal drinking age, and I mean, we think that we, just because we aren't going to be doing a survey, it means that we are not, we actually may do more by doing our own than we've done by doing the state survey. That's my point. You have to ask, I know this is a field that you're very close to, but at some point I ask myself, beyond the, you know, the comparison data, what are we really doing with this information? What, and do we need that in order to have the educational conversations that we should have? That's, I guess, what we're trying to get at.
I would encourage, if we have these conversations, which I think are fantastic and incredibly helpful, if there's some way to perhaps loop in some information to go home to
I think the questions that we ultimately ask, the results of that ought to be made public. I mean, I would envision, I want to make sure that Jeff hears me. Jeff, I would just like to be sure that we're in agreement.
It was a germane conversation.
Knock that stuff off. So I just want to be sure that I'm not saying something that you don't agree with.
Well, hopefully,
I'm thinking mostly of Mike and Jeff, that you will come up with some questions that you're going to ask students, and the results of that you will share with the school board and you'll share with parents. I hope. Is that fair to say?
Absolutely.
Mike, are you okay with that?
You were practicing.
Mike. Okay, well, I guess that I think that what Joe is saying is that in the ideal world, this data generates conversations at home. So if we do generate data through a homegrown survey, it'd be nice to share it with parents so that they could have a conversation at the dinner table with their children about, well, what do you make of this? I see that the results said this. What's your opinion? I mean, it just, right. Nothing.
What are you talking about at school with regards to
right.
This?
Yeah. Okay, so that would happen.
Howard, did we just miss the deadline,
yes.
Or did we choose not to do it?
The deadline.
Oh, okay.
I missed the deadline. Although I will tell you, subconsciously, can I just say something?
I used to be, and Joe, I know this is dear.
I'm being really good, aren't I?
You've been very, very good.
Thank you.
I used to be a huge proponent of this survey, and I like the survey. The turnaround time on getting the results of the survey has gotten so long that we can energize kids and families around a conversation about data that we collect, that we can give, we can circle back and get and feedback to parents and students within 2 weeks. It literally takes almost a year at this point for us to get the results of that survey.
I don't think it's going to be any quicker this year.
I
know it won't be. However, I do have to sort of defend the survey just for the record.
It's
an incredible way of accumulating trend data. And our data contributes to county data, which then contributes to statewide data. And so it's not just our own, although it's useful, and I don't think things have changed that drastically from 2005 to 2017, but from 2017 to 2007, you can start to see where things may come off.
And I will just speak for myself and say, I'm not philosophically opposed to doing it again in the future if the decision is made that.
However, I do appreciate, actually I really appreciate the proactive thinking about, because the point of the data is to have these conversations and to look deeply into the community to find out what is driving your perceptions and your reality around physical activity, nutrition, and substance misuse. And so to do that in a very comprehensive, and I'm more than happy to help in creating some of those surveys. We can pull from a bank of national, you know, risk value, high value, low risk questions that are valid and reliable.
I think we just thought it was important to have a district-wide approach to this, and I appreciate Jeff being candid about missing the deadline and in discussion. It didn't make sense to us to just survey a very small amount of our population. So in that interest, we joined the high school in not surveying.
I think yeah, you were on the bandwagon. And then as far as the K-6, I don't think they do sixth grade anymore. They never did fourth grade, but those are send home questionnaires anyway to parents, and they select only about 200 families across the state to participate in those district level surveys. So you're totally off the hook.
So the last thing, so thank you for offering to, so you have an offer here to help put together a survey, maybe some health teachers sitting down with you and Joe. And okay, so you may see something more about that later this year, and we would have a quick turnaround on our results. It'd be like, okay. So the last thing I'll say is that I was approached by Noel in our office saying that this arrangement used to be elevated, apparently, and you can see that they've made a change. And the question is, they need to upgrade the sound system in this building, and if you want to continue to meet at the high school, they need to upgrade the sound system there. In all respects, the filming equipment, the sound, the speakers. So he feels that now that it's on the same floor, if you're comfortable having all your meetings here to include workshops, they could make it a bit more a more friendly arrangement of tables to get people in more of a circle to talk, face each other, as opposed to an audience.
Because they just couldn't. We were on a big raised stage.
He said they can do that now, and it would save them the cost of buying additional speakers and film equipment. But if you don't want, if for some reason that's being at the high school is what you want, he needs to know that. So,
do we meet at the high school because we don't want to be filmed? Or do we meet at the high school?
He said that those meetings aren't filmed. He told me that they're filmed.
They're not.
Just budget.
They're not.
Only budget.
Okay, that's what it is. Only budget, okay.
And I'm
assuming. So we wouldn't have to pay for, even on workshop nights, we don't have to be, even if it's here.
But my question was, are we also meeting there because this room isn't available because of other public meetings? Because it seems like this is pretty busy.
May I just say that we didn't even just hear that conversation. It was just that this sound system here is terrible.
Well, the acoustics.
We've heard that.
It's terrible.
Yeah. The
and
acoustics
are. And we can't hear what they're saying. So if you lean back, and even if it's all people. So any place that could have better sound would be wonderful.
Well, we have the TV here. So
right.
We will speak more loudly. How's that?
Thank you.
I'll lean in.
So I guess I just. I saw that request, and I didn't see anything wrong with it on face value. I guess my question was that tradition developed simply because we could have that workshop-type feel in the high school library, and we never could before when we had that big wooden... if we don't understand why it needs to be at the high school, then I guess I don't think we need to spend extra money to keep it at the high school.
I agree.
Okay. Yeah.
I agree as well.
And then we never have to wonder if we're going to high school or town. Right.
I won't get any more texts. Where are we meeting?
Where are
actually,
you?
That's an advantage for the public. Too.
It is an advantage yeah.
It is
for
an
the
advantage
public.
To everyone.
Okay, I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you, Howard.
I would like to, and I will make this super brief, the deadline has passed for superintendent applications. The advisory screening committee will begin work tomorrow. Packets will be available for screening upstairs in the department office. Each member will need to sign a confidentiality agreement, and then we'll be allowed to
read and do their screening tool. Those materials must stay inside the building. And then there's a week of business days when the department office is open, so people can make their own schedules to go in and do that. Howard has generously offered his office, and Kathy has also offered her office when they're not, you know, in there doing private business, that people can be in there doing work. Next, so that starts tomorrow, which is the 11th, and then Wednesday the 18th. The culmination of that work will happen in the evening right here in the Jordan Conference Room, where the Advisory Screening Committee will meet and bring together their completed screening tools and begin the discussion to make their recommendations to the school board about interviews, which will then take place the following week.
And then it's an executive session, so it's not open to the public.
It is not open to the public. So that's where we are in the process. So moving on to new business, item 6A, kind of starts on the bottom of one page and moves to the next. May I have a motion, please?
I move we approve the 2016-2017 athletic and co-curricular, leaning forward, personnel nominations as outlined in our evening's agenda.
I second.
Discussion?
I did have one question. Chris Drake is an incredibly energetic young man. Can he be in two places at once, or are those sports meeting at a different schedule? I'm assuming it's a different schedule.
Good question, but...
Well, you could appoint, and then you, I guess you could just check with him. Is it
double check, won't you? How about middle school? Does have short seasons?
They yeah. do. Or do they? Oh, so I don't think
maybe they don't know them.
That could be a thing too.
My recollection is he did both last year. So.
Incredible memory.
Michael, still just give us a quick check.
So are we prepared to approve and just,
mm-hmm.
yes, okay.
Further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6B, may I have a motion, please? Oh, and there's no motion required, I apologize.
That's okay. As policy chair, I'd be happy to walk you very quickly through this as a first read. This is policy JICK, for those of you listening, bullying and cyberbullying prevention in schools. CAPE has a bullying prevention policy now, but there has been some movement at the sort of throughout the state to add some teeth and rigor to policies that all schools have in place. So we were requested to review policy and to consider language that the legislature's stakeholder group has come up with. It was first presented to us through the Maine School Management Association. It was quite lengthy. Principals and the policy committee and Howard waded through that one night. Then Drummond Woodsum got their hands on it and shortened it tremendously and made it much more accessible for our conversations. And so what you're seeing is Drummond Woodsum's take on what came from the state. And I'd like to thank the principals for sitting through this with us three different evenings, going through a lot of information on a topic that's very important to all of us. And so what you see in front of you is pretty much the Drummond Woodsum language with a few reflections of our discussions. The biggest change is in the procedural pieces at the end. So let me just, for purposes of people listening, the first part talks about the definition of bullying and cyberbullying. It's pretty straightforward. It includes, but is not limited to, a pattern of written, oral, or electronic expression or physical act or gesture or any combination thereof directed at a student or students that has a reasonable, as a reasonable person would expect it to have the effect of physical harm, placing a student in fear of physical harm or damage, or interferes with the rights of student by creating a hostile educational environment, is essentially the second part of it. goes on to describe cyberbullying, which sadly we're all hearing more and more about these days, and then the application of policy, consequences for students, school employees and others. This includes everyone, not just students, and the requirement that there is staff training at the start of every year in some timely way so that everyone is aware of their responsibilities. Delegation of responsibility, it's pretty close to the principal's heart for the most part, but we added language so that assistant principals and school counselors also are part of the reporting group wherever a student feels most comfortable going when they're experiencing a problem. The second part is the administrative procedures, J-I-C-K-R, and that's where it talks about the report formats, the bullying reports, how they're made, students and parents and guardians, school employees, the form of the report, the interim safety measures, which are often not talked about as much as they should be, because that's a really key part for kids to then feel safe in an atmosphere where they may have a reported otherwise. And then the investigation aspect and the response to bullying by students, which lists a whole a long list of possible options, and as well as how are the parents of the victim and the parents of the alleged bullier kept in the loop of what's going on, and when we want our superintendent of schools to be aware. In the materials we got were then 5 separate reports about the investigation, the conclusions, the responses, and so forth. And I literally watched as our principals drooped in their chairs because it was a lot of work. So with thanks to Principal Shedd, he took all the requirements of those forms and put them into this one sort of flowing investigation record document that captures the gist of what was required at every level. The witness statements, who's reporting, what are follow-up steps, summary of action taken, etc. And also noting that there is a right of appeal should any step of the way not feel quite right to a family through the superintendent whose decision is final. So I will tell you that what we pass when we vote must be run by the DOE by approval this spring. It's my hope that certainly in JICK and JICKR, we haven't changed the tone. We did change the report mechanism, and I think he was careful enough that this will pass muster at the state level. But I may need to bring it back to you should there be any slight tweak needed. But I'm really pleased to bring it to you tonight. It really is the culmination of three months worth of looking, with thanks to Heather and Kim and also John, who was on the initial conversations.
It's a lot of work.
So a quick question, and I would like to extend my thanks because this is important work and a lot of people put so much time into it, as you mentioned. So as we're looking at the response to bullying by students, my one question, and I'm not suggesting that we need to add this, but timeliness is often a very important factor. Yes. Timeliness. Mm-hmm. And
you talk about bullying reports. On
I think meeting with students and meeting with the students' parents and those sort of things, there really is there's a time element here where it should be a very short window,
right,
of that, you know, initial, the phone call, the conversation, that sort of thing. And that doesn't always happen. And that can exacerbate any issue. Mm-hmm. And so do we feel like that's just going to be built in through administrative procedures? And I'm not asking that we add that, but I just kind of want to raise an awareness to.
There was a section in here, trying to remember, where it talked about us stipulating within X days the report be completed. And we talked about it, the principals all are, seemed to be a high priority for them. So rather than put an artificial number of days on, it was to be completed in a reasonable amount of time. And so that was our understanding. Certainly there's place for the board to stipulate a number of days should that feel more comfortable to you.
And I understand not wanting that artificial number in there. I just kind of wanted to raise that question around. past circumstances showing that sometimes those conversations aren't happening in a timely manner, and they really need to.
They need to be.
So I think without putting us in too tight of a box, I think you may be able to address some of those concerns in two ways, one of which is a statement that it is our policy to be timely, and the requirement that you record the times of the incidents and follow-ups, so that you actually, there's a requirement to actually write down when the response occurs, and that you have a overall policy of timeliness. It doesn't give you such a tight timeline, but adds that urgency to at a procedural level.
Mm-hmm. Yep, that's a bit
because
comfortable.
You get what you track.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Mm-hmm. Happy to bring that to our next policy meeting.
So, thank you.
So I have one additional comment, as I was involved in a lot of the original discussions around the description of bullying itself, and I think it was a smart move in terms of talking about, in general, a pattern of behavior. I do have two additional concerns that we may wish to think about accommodating, and it had to do with, most of my thinking had to do with interactions of students within their own class and peer groups, but at a school, that's not always what happens. And there are two circumstances where I would like to give potentially building administrators discretion to include them as potential incidents of bullying, and that is where there is a clear difference in number. If it's multiple students and one student, there's a presumption one event can constitute bullying, and the other one is the differences in ages. In my mind, sort of anything beyond two grades difference, there's sort of a presumption that there's a rebuttable presumption that sort of interaction may be bullying, because think about a ninth grader interacting with a sixth grader, or a sixth grader with a third grader, anything that sort of happens beyond that 2-year gap, to me seems like there's almost a rebuttable presumption that you may wish to fall under the bullying procedure on a single event rather than requiring an entire pattern. And that's a result of the unique situations that fall outside of just one's peer group, within one's peer group, and it's one-to-one, I think a pattern sort of makes sense. You don't want to be writing up bullying reports for every push or shove or things that happen that are minor occurrences and friction that happen frequently, that they don't fall into that category. But thinking about those inherent power mismatches that occur in a single incident, I think it's important to try and cast that net so that they're included.
I want you to look at the net on page 3 of 4 on JICKR, because I actually brought your point to the committee, John, because mm-hmm. I remember you felt strongly about that. The principals explained that they use wide discretion, single incident, maturity of the students involved, numbers. So if you note here, the determination of whether particular conduct constitutes bullying requires reasonable consideration of the circumstances, which includes the frequency of the behavior at issue, the location in which it occurs, the ages and maturity of the students involved, the activity or context in which the conduct occurs, and the nature and severity of the conduct. They felt that gave them very wide berth to call a spade a spade when their sense is bullying happened, whether it's once, whether it involved little kids and older kids, or whether this was something, like you said, more than a peer group where you're looking for a pattern. Yep. So again, I was trusting our administrators to use really good discretion given that bit of language. Mm-hmm. Does that feel comfortable? That's the start of the administrative procedure, JICKR.
The thing that where we might want to adjust it is has to do with, I don't want someone reading this to think that the pattern is an out. The description of it says including but not limited to a pattern. I think we may want to be explicit that in some cases it may be a single event.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So that's the only that's the
then that would make you feel more comfortable.
I think that provides the, and in the circumstances that I've, two circumstances I've described, and there may be more, those are circumstances where I think the power dynamics are clear, that it can occur in a single incident.
I agree with you. We'll look at that at the next meeting. Thank you. Anything else you'd like us to consider?
Thank you for looking into this. It's very important.
Okay, thank you.
Good work. Thank you. So no action is needed at this time. Moving on to item 6C, may I have a motion, please?
I move we approve Ted Jordan's AP U.S. government trip to Washington, D.C., March 21st through the 24th, 2017.
Second. Discussion? My understanding is that this is not the first time Mr. Jordan has ever done this. And having read that everybody has the opportunity, I always like to ask those questions, and everybody nods.
Mr. Schitt's going as well. Is that, am I correct about that?
Yeah, yes. I'm teaching one section.
So this is, right. But this is a year after year kind of trip. Lots of people have that opportunity. Fundraising is available if necessary, or?
There is some money that we can use, and we do every year to support families who need some additional support.
You're going to a Nationals baseball game?
There we go.
Yeah. I was about to say that I think as a school district, you can reserve spots for the Black History Museum.
That's one of the places we ended up talking
about.
Any further questions or discussion?
Exciting.
All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6D, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve to replace to the school board's 2016-17 superintendent search interview committee to insert Faith Barnes from the elementary school.
Second.
I'll just let you know that there was a teacher representative from the elementary school who wasn't able to keep that commitment and brought that to the board really quickly, and Principal Hassan and the teachers were able to quickly turn around and find a replacement. So I'm thankful to all of them, and especially for Faith Barnes for stepping up to do this part.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
All those in favor? Thank you. Item 6E, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we approve the boys' tennis team trip to Vandermeer Tennis Academy in Hilton Head, North Carolina, April 14th through the 22nd of this year.
Second.
My understanding, again, is that this is a very long-standing trip. I actually went on this trip from a neighboring school with this Cape Elizabeth team.
I just have a quick question. In 1992, 3, 4, and 5, the girls went too. So when did the girls stop going?
They went a few years ago.
Did they go first?
Yeah.
But I'm just thinking.
I think it depends on interest. Well, I was going to ask Jeff too, but
I'm almost positive they have gone much more recently.
Yeah, much more recently.
No, I know. I'm being facetious because I went on those. So I'm just wondering why only the boys are under just Title IX stuff. Why is just the boys' team going and not the girls?
That's a great question. I can get the answer to that question. I sort of think that maybe that we all need years, but I'm 100% certain of that.
I'd love an answer on that. It'd be great, Jeff. Thank you.
I don't want to speak out of school, but being a neighboring coach in a neighboring town who's friendly with the women's coach and the men's coach, I didn't know that the men and women went together maybe last year or the year before.
So there's some
reason. I'm just curious. You can ask Andy, but it just could be interest.
Yeah, I'm just interested too. So I'll make sure the opportunity is
equal. Just double check that the opportunity was extended to the women.
Thank you.
And then it is fairly expensive.
It is.
And so
it's pricey.
It's $1,400. Do we have fundraising opportunities, help for students, families who can't afford, you know, what do we have that going on?
It's an expensive trip.
It's a pretty expensive trip.
Great. Thank you.
The power of the internet.
So,
do we approve this with outstanding questions?
I would.
Pardon?
I would.
Yeah, we can just get the answers on those.
I need to get going.
It's a long, longstanding trip. So if, Jeff, you'll just get back to us. Great. All those in favor? Thank you. Item 7, committee reports. We've heard from policy. Do you want to just circle back around?
I would circle around to, well, it kind of comes in upcoming meetings too, but let me just say real quickly that what we still have before us is a relook at CAPE's volunteer policy, and John Holdridge has written some suggestions for us, and will be at the February 7 meeting to talk with us about it. Mm-hmm. And in March, as you noticed in the program of studies, it will start to go public, and it's going to be public at the policy committee about diploma requirements. And that's one of the things on our agenda for this spring, as well as curriculum development policy and promotion, retention, acceleration of students. But I think Mrs. Stankard is most anxious to bring graduation requirements to us in March. So we have a kind of robust agenda ahead of us, but I don't want to cut off any other thoughts you may have about what we should be looking at in these 4 months. And Superintendent Coulter is also asking for some help taking a look at the wellness policy and has given some outreach to staff to maybe start taking a look at that and giving us some recommendations. So that's kind of what's on our plate. And when we do upcoming meeting announcements, I'll mention our dates.
Okay. Thank you.
So in regards to the wellness policy, I do believe that there is the SNAP Ed and the 5210 staff within public health organizations like Opportunity Alliance that are more than happy to provide technical assistance. If you want to bring them in for their expertise on those policies, I'm sure they would be happy to be asked. Yeah.
Thank you.
Of the technology and steering committee, Kimberly and I met with Noel Haroff last week, and we're going to meet with them again tomorrow. There's urgency to communicating because of the MLTI program that has been cut, will be cut, or is going to be cut starting next year, and will no longer be funding iPads or laptops. So if I understand that correctly. What?
If it passes.
Oh, thank you.
We hope.
Okay. So I think the biggest question is how to, you know, assuming that's how, the direction we're headed, and it sure looks like it, you know, how do we want to deal with our, what choices do we want to make going forward? And, you know, Kimberly and I still need to get more input and information from Noel and teachers and, but that includes, like, do we go the route of a tablet? Do we go back to the route of a laptop? And I know for 7th and 8th grade, that's what they've switched to. Or do we expect families to pay and bring their own, you know, students bring their own? And or do we, you know, go away from, from what I understand, what Noel said, switching from, let's say, Apple to a different device,
a PC,
is not really the issue, which I was, you know, I was surprised to hear. But so these are sort of, it's a big question about the next, like, 5 years, which direction we're heading and how we're going to move ahead and what will be best, because the technology will always be changing, and if we're responsible for these systems, or if we're expecting the families to be responsible, you know, we all have to take all of this into consideration. So it has mm-hmm. to work quickly and thoughtfully.
I think too, reaching out to Rebecca Millett and other people in the legislature to find out, is there support for the governor's wish to cut the Milty program, and, you know.
So the most recent info is that they're committed to the program through 2020.
For 7th and 8th graders.
Yeah.
Only 7th and 8th graders.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you. Any word on Spurwink School?
No. We are still waiting to find, there's no date.
Okay. Any other committee?
Buildings and grounds.
Buildings and grounds meet, yes.
We meet tomorrow at 1:30 in Howard's office for the first time.
Anybody, any other reports? Okay. School board agenda requests, item 8.
Don't all jump at once.
Crickets. Okay, moving on to, oh.
Did you want to, I just didn't know what you wanted to do with the comment made about the ninth grade physics.
Oh.
Did you want a report on that or not? I mean, we could encourage the lady to go speak with somebody in our schools about that, unless, I mean, are you curious to know more about it, or if not, we could direct her toward the high school or toward Kathy, and they could just sit down and explain to her what we're doing.
Just from my perspective, it feels like part of a bigger question that we're hoping to have that conversation with our director of teaching and learning around, you know, K-12 alignment and, you know, scope and sequence and timing of math and that sort of thing. So I think it's a wonderful question that fits into an upcoming workshop that we hope to have. Yeah. And it feels like a workshop topic, not a business meeting topic.
Yeah.
But I could,
So maybe sometime this year.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Mm-hmm. And if perhaps that woman wants a earlier one-on-one answer, we could provide her that option.
I don't know her.
I don't either.
Yeah.
Okay. McCulka.
Okay, good.
So that's Kathy McCulka.
Announcements of upcoming meetings, item 9. So we'll go back around to Susanna and Barbara.
Okay, so tomorrow, as you mentioned earlier, begins the first day of the superintendent search screening committee's ability to review the applications, and then we meet to discuss and make our recommendations to the board next, is it Wednesday the 18th? And then tomorrow evening is the first scheduled the town comprehensive plan meeting that I'm going to. So I don't know what, that's all I know. Sorry.
Date and time is good.
Tomorrow at 7 here. Yes, thank you.
Technology meeting?
The town comprehensive technology
is all met in next meeting.
Well, the technology meeting is just tomorrow between Noel and Kimberly and I, so it's just trying to get brought up to date.
Barbara,
policy has settled into meeting the first Tuesday of the month when there's not a board meeting at 6:30. So our next meeting was scheduled for February 7 at 6:30. But while Mike and Jeff are here, I'd put a bug in your ear that at least one person who had hoped to attend to hear a discussion about volunteer policy has an elementary concert conflict and had asked if there was any flexibility in the date. Policy committee members are kind of checking their schedules. I'll put out an email to see if we can start it perhaps earlier, 5 o'clock, 5:30, or the Thursday morning, which worries me a little bit because then we're late getting information to Andrea for board packets if there's any changes for the second read policy. So we will try to accommodate the best we can based on everyone's schedules, and perhaps we can meet a little earlier should they choose to come. Also, I would like to say anyone who knows we're considering particular policies who would like to submit comments in writing, we're happy to review those as well. It doesn't always require a personal presence for us to sincerely read and understand any parent or other community member concerns.
Okay. Thank you.
So we'll post that time as soon as it's finalized.
Thank you. Any other upcoming meetings? Okay. Item 10, may I have a motion, please?
I move that we adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor?
That was a little enthusiastic.
A little.
Thank you.